Now, let me tell you a story now, if I may. Most comedians finish work at sort of 10:30, 11, and invariably will drive home wherever possible. So getting in at maybe 12 or 1 or 2. Me, personally, when I get home, in order to get the adrenaline out of my system so I can sleep at all, I will do one of two things. I'm not a drinker, so I'll either have a bath or I'll watch a bit of telly. And normally one of those two things will work. Every now and again, though, they don't work and I can't sleep at all. It's rare. I'm lucky like that, but it does happen. The last time it happened to any degree was February last year. I got in from work. I did the usual things. No success. I did the worst thing you can possibly do when you can't sleep, which is go on the internet, because it probably wakes you up, doesn't it? But I'd sort of abandoned the idea of sleep, and I was happily clicking from website to website. Now, 2:30 is a normal time for me to go to bed. When it starts to get to 3, 3:30, I start to feel tired and, I suppose, just a bit lonely, I suppose, and a little bit like I'm the only person awake in the world. And I know that my tired brain does things that my rested brain would never allow. Now, if we go back to the beginning of the story, I mentioned that I got divorced. I got married the first time at 22 and divorced at 29. I suppose getting married at 22 is quite young, but I was very much swept off my feet. I think the main reason I said yes to going out with him in the first place was the fact that he wrote me a poem. Nobody had written me a poem before. Nobody has written me a poem since. I don't really know much about poetry, but I know that this was just lovely. He'd handwritten it. He gave it to me on a sheet of paper, and I read it, and I just fell. I remember folding it really small, and I put it in my purse. And every time I had, like, a shitty day at work, I'd get on the bus to go home, and I'd get my poem out, and I'd read it to myself. And I'd think, somebody feels this way about me, to have written this about me. I'm not having a shitty day anymore. Now, a little after 5 years, I lost it. To this day, I have no idea where it went, and I was distraught. It meant so much to me. But after a while, after I'd calmed down, I thought, I wonder if I've memorised it from all of those times of reading it to myself. So I got a sheet of paper and a pen, and sure enough, it all came out. And I folded it up small, and I put it back in my purse where it belonged. Now, if we scoot ahead to February last year, it's 3:30 a.m. I'm tired, and I'm on the internet. And I just thought, we've been divorced 9 years. That was a lovely poem. I bet he's given it to somebody else. I bet it's on a blog. I bet some skinny 22-year-old fucking bitch has got it as a Facebook status. So I picked a line from it, and I Googled it. And there were 305,000 examples of the poem. It wasn't my poem. It wasn't his poem. It was written by Samuel Coleridge. No wonder it was fucking good. But I felt sort of broken, like my heart had been broken all over again. I felt hurt and a little bit stupid. I didn't really know what to do with this new information. So I texted my fella on the off chance that he was still awake, and he was, thank God, and he rang and he said, what's up? And I told him the whole thing. And my fella's a very sensible man. And he had a little think, and he said, just because that was a lie doesn't mean the rest was a lie. And I thought, that's pretty good. So I hung up from him, but I still wasn't happy. It was still whirling around in my head. What was starting to happen that I didn't like was it was starting to colour my idea of my ex-husband. It was starting to make me think of him as a bad person. And he wasn't a bad person. We split up relatively amicably. He just stopped loving me, which is very sad and hard for me to understand, given the fact that I'm awesome. Good, I'm glad you agree. But it felt to me like he was a bowl of clear water with a drop of blue dye about to go in and colour the whole thing, and I didn't think that was fair on him. And I was thinking, I wonder if I can come up with another example of something similar. Somebody who is inherently good, but has done one bad thing, but you still think of them as a good person. And I racked my brains and I could think of no one. I did, however, think of an example of the opposite. Somebody who was inherently bad, but had done one good thing, but I still thought of them as a bad person. And that person was Margaret Thatcher. I understand the concept of not speaking ill of the dead, but I also understand that I told this story for the first time while she was still alive. And coming from a mining background, I will not allow her to ruin my show. The
the way she ruined the lives of my dad and his friends. Now, one thing you might not know about Margaret Thatcher is that she was partly responsible for the invention of Mr. Whitby ice cream. She studied science at university. She was one of a team of scientists who invented the machine that puts the air through the ice cream to create Mr. Whitby ice cream. So for all of the atrocities that I believe she committed, Mr. Whitby ice cream's still pretty fucking nice, isn't it? But it felt to me very much like she was still a ball of blue dye with a drop of clear water hovering above the surface. And I went to bed and I slept like a baby. And I woke up the next morning and I still felt okay. And I thought, I'm going to ring my dad. Now, my dad is an exceptional listener. My dad is my second port of call, always after my fella, if I have anything troubling me. And I told him the whole thing and he listened very quietly. And I said, so do you see how I've worked it out that none of us are 100% good or bad? We're all a mixture of the two. He said, yes, I can see what you've done. I said, did you know about the ice cream thing? He said, no, I didn't. I said, so how does that make you feel now? And he went quiet. It couldn't have been for minutes. It must have only been for seconds, but it felt like a long time. And he went, you really want to know how I feel? I said, I think it would help me, Dad. He went quiet again. And he went, you're not allowed Mr. Whitby anymore. In the space of about 6 hours, I'd lost my poem and Mr. Whitby for life. I didn't tell him that Osama bin Laden invented midget gems. He didn't. There's people over there going, did he? He didn't.
Hello, it's Sarah Millican here. Please make sure you subscribe to my channel to stay up to date with all of my latest videos. Don't forget to like, pop a comment below, and why not stick around to watch a few more? I'm sure those emails or those dishes can wait a bit longer.